Welcome everyone to tonight's meeting of the Burlington City Council on today, March 5th, 2019. I'd like to take a moment to ask everyone to please silence all electronic devices. At this time, we call on Councilmember Bob Ward for our invocation.
Let's bow our heads, please. The City Council tonight will remember City Employee Barry McCauley, who recently passed away. We ask for a special blessing for Barry's family as they deal with their loss. Our city has recently experienced a sharp increase in drug overdose cases. We ask for guidance as we search for ways to address this critical problem of drug abuse in our community. We express our gratitude to all city staff for their commitment and dedication to making our city a safe and healthy place to live and work. As we are again reminded and remain grateful for the many freedoms of our democracy, we ask for direction on how to equitably and effectively meet our responsibilities to our citizens and our city. We ask that our actions be guided by the highest standards of ethics and that our personal faiths give us the strength to act honestly and fairly in all matters before us tonight. We ask your blessings on our city, state, and country. Amen.
We have a special remembrance this evening. At this time, I'll recognize our city manager, Harden Watkins.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Just wanted to share a few words. Councilmember Ward mentioned Barry McCauley, our city employee, passed away February 19th, and he worked for us in the Water Resources Department at the East Burlington Wastewater Treatment Plant. I want to take this time to just remember Barry's family. His deceased parents are Walter and Mary Whitted McCauley. He has two children here in the community, Tavian and Brianna, and one grandchild. Barry was a dedicated employee. His coworkers would tell him he would always go the extra mile, always willing to help out his coworkers. Did the same for his friends and his personal life, always willing to step up and help. Incredibly hard worker. Bob Patterson, our water resource director, shared with me about Barry's work ethic. And also talking about his personal life, Barry stepped up a few years ago to take care of his aging parents as they were having some health needs and as they were aging, and folks, certainly his coworkers, admired him for that. He's a Navy veteran and a fellow UNC fan, so we just want to take a few minutes to remember Barry today and just acknowledge we appreciate his faithful service to the city and that we remember, keep all his family, friends, and colleagues in our thoughts. Thank you.
We have two recognitions this evening. We'll begin with a recognition for Jess Arias, our Animal Services Director. At this time, I'll call on Assistant City Manager Rachel Kelly and Jess Arias.
All right. Thanks for giving me an opportunity to share with you an achievement of Jess Arias's. On the 21st of February, Jess was recognized as one of the Triad Business Journal's top 40 leaders under 40. For the past 16 years, the Triad Business Journal has been recognizing outstanding leaders under 40 that have made an impact in their professional lives and in their community. And it's clear to me that our honoree has done both. Jess has transformed the landscape of animal welfare in our community by aligning the best staff in the business, an army of passionate volunteers, strategic rescue partners, and donors to support the mission of BAS. The statistics speak for themselves. We had 28% pets, that had positive outcomes in 2013, and last year there were 90% pets with positive outcomes. That doesn't happen in open admission shelters, well, very rarely. As you're aware, Jess also helped secure a public-private partnership to get the animal services building going. That's under construction now, and we're excited to see that up and running next year. So I think this is really exciting. As you know, it's a big deal. And now I'll let Jess say a few words.
All right. I didn't know I was being expected to say a few words, but I want to thank you for this opportunity, obviously, to serve my community and make a difference for pets and people in our community and county. And I'm really honored to receive this award, and thank you to each of you for your support for our department year after year. It really makes a difference, and we're really proud of our efforts at Animal Services, and it's not so much me as it is the great team behind me that makes it happen every day. So I really appreciate all the folks at Animal Services. They're very hard workers, and not just the staff, but all the volunteers. Couldn't do it without all the community involvement and the support from all of our leaders in the community. So thank you.
Mr. Mayor, before I think we ought to give Jessica a round of applause, but before we do that, can we ask all of Jessica's colleagues from Animal Services to stand up? I see a number of folks here. She certainly wants to acknowledge and recognize her team. So thank you all.
For our next recognition, I'll call on Councilmember Harold Owen.
Mayor, thank you. For many of you who lived here and some are new residents, welcome. But traditionally here in our community, the Cummins track team, both men and women, have been enormously successful to a point of not only just on the state level, but also nationally. And not only in terms of track, but more importantly, academically. Many of these people have earned significant academic recognition and scholarships leading to higher education opportunities. One of the reasons for that is one of our own, Don Davis, our former sanitation director, who's been a long-time coach there. Don is not more than a coach. I think he's a mentor and sometimes maybe serves in some parenting roles over the process, and his dedication to this, a non-paid position I may add, it's been just unbelievable, and frankly, I'm not sure we can ever determine the number of lives that he's effectively touched in his tenure at Cummins. Both Don's children attended Cummins. His son was an All-American football player that played at Georgia Tech. His daughter, All-American in track and field, that went to UNC Chapel Hill, and then I think got her postgraduate degree from University of Texas. So he's had a really overall enormous impact on our community. So if I could recognize Don tonight, and he's going to recognize the young ladies.
Those of you that know me, I'm going to tell you up front, I'm not going to speak long, but you know how it is when I start talking about our athletes. But anyway, I appreciate your inviting us here. And these young ladies just won the 1A-2A indoor state championship in track and field. And this makes the 25th state championship that our girls have won since 1987, so that's 25 and 32 years. But it was 1987 that I started coaching, and that first year I ended up helping a young lady get a scholarship to North Carolina A&T, and it was the first scholarship that a female had received from Cummins High School. So at that point, it just occurred to me that this is a way to get these kids a chance for higher education, especially the ones that didn't have the resources or the privilege or the money to go to school. So from that point, I kind of developed a plan. And it was a good thing that I was the sanitation superintendent, because I could get off work, go to practice, then take the kids to Durham or whatever. But it allowed me the opportunity to do what I really wanted to do with them. So our plan at Cummins High School is to, as freshmen and sophomores, prepare them for their life. So we never have big teams. We only have five girls that competed at the state championship. And sometimes we're competing against 30, 40, or whatever. But they'll tell you, 5 times 4 equals what, 20? And that's what they do. When they go to a track meet, they go to work. And it's our plan is to put them in the right position so that they can be successful in life. And it's one thing that we never had a problem with. And at the end of the day, when they offer a scholarship, academics has never been a problem. So by the second semester of their junior year, we always want them in position academically as well as athletically to take advantage of the scholarships that's going to be offered them in July. So So I'll just go through the girls. Tamisha is the one that was hurt this year. She's a freshman, and she really didn't get a chance to do a lot. But she was there every day at practice, at every track meet, and always trying to get us to figure out some way that she could contribute. But she's got 3.5 years left to do what she needs to do. Isis Martinez, she's my other freshman, and Isis qualified for the state meet in the 500 meter dash and in the triple jump. She finished ninth in the 500. Kendall Jordan is a sophomore. Kendall qualified for the state championship really in 6 events, but she can only run 4. She won the triple jump, finished second in the 500 meter dash, finished second in the 55 meter hurdles, and she was on our 4x400 relay team that finished first. Kendall was also the state championship MVP. Okay, now our juniors, Alicia Farrar. Alicia won the 55 meter dash. She won the 300 meter dash and set our school record in the 300, which if you set a school record at Cummins High School, you're doing quite a bit, okay? But she also was the fourth leg of our 4x4 that won. Alicia is ranked number 25th in the junior class, and she's gonna be highly recruited, okay? Jadea Fawcett. Jadea won the long jump. She finished fourth in the triple jump. She finished fifth in the 55 meter hurdles, and she was also on our 4x4 relay team that won state. And Jadea is ranked number 6 in the junior class. And we have one other young lady that was unable to make it, Brittany Aguilar. And Brittany finished 8th in the 55 meter hurdles. She was on our 4x4, and she's ranked number 1 in the junior class. So among the 5 that we competed at the state championship, 3 are ranked in the top 25 as juniors. So you can see where I'm going with this thing. I have no question that, you know, athletically, they've already proven that they're scholarship material. Academically, it's the same thing. And they'll tell you, we have rules that nobody else have. And they're what you might call old school rules, but they're rules. And you know, I wouldn't give anything for them because I know how hard they work. And it's kind of interesting that you know, it's hard for them to get the recognition that I think they should get simply because they're not football players or basketball players. But the difference in what they do and what you would do on a football team or a basketball team, football, basketball, you always have a 50-50 chance of winning. Alicia was in the 300 meters at the Eastern Challenge, and they had 89 athletes in there, and she won. So she had 1 in 89 chances of winning. So, you know, this is something that is, you know, is something that is going to pave the way for them. And the thing is, we've had kids who really were, they didn't have a chance. And now they've already graduated college. We've had over 40 athletes to get college scholarships. I have 6 from Cummins High School right now that are in college on track scholarships. I have 1 that was just recognized as the Scholar Athlete of the Week at Northern Illinois University. I have another one that just made the NCAA National Championship in the hurdles, Isaiah Moore. And Isaiah is also the top, he's the top student athlete at the University of South Carolina. So, you know, when it comes down to it, we're gonna do well. And so, you know, anytime you get a chance to contribute to Cummins High School track and field, you're doing a good thing, because you know, we have it behind us. My daughter went all the way through getting a PhD because of track. I never had to pay a dime to send her to school because of track. And I always say it's amazing that we don't have more people taking advantage of it. But we also have a summer program that the Durham Striders, that we basically run out of Cummins High School, and that encompasses kids from everywhere, you know. And what we do at Cummins, it's not just about Cummins. We actually have athletes from Williams, the Burlington School, all over the place be at our, you know, be at Cummins High School, because the coaches will call and ask if their athletes can come and train with us. So, you know, that's what we do. And while I'm telling you this, we need to get some hurdles. I've had hurdles that come to high schools since before I was there, and I need to replace some hurdles.
Yeah.
So if anybody, when you were there, so we have the same hurdles. So if anybody want to contribute, buy me a flight of hurdles, I would appreciate it. But anyway, this is your future, and you know, we say track is our business, and business is always good. So, hey, thank you.
Let's be honest, when Todd was there, those tracks was hurdled a lot lower, though.
Yeah, I need Jim. There we go.
Is that good?
Yes. Thank you.
We got some, just giving some hints.
Did y'all get your fix for the thing? Let's try this again when you're done.
From our February 4th and February 19th meetings. Do I hear a motion to approve those minutes?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Minutes have been approved. Next, we have two add-ons to our consent agenda. Item J, to set a day of public hearing for Alamance West Apartments contiguous voluntary annexation. And item K, to set a day of public hearing for the Huffman Point contiguous voluntary annexation. Do I hear a motion to approve those add-ons?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Add-ons have been approved. We also have one removal
Thanks, Mr. Mayor. Staff would ask the council remove item G from the potential items being considered as the consent agenda. That's a carnival permit. The applicant withdrew the application due to the availability of that location, so it does not appear there'll be a carnival at that time. Therefore, it doesn't need to be on the agenda.
Do I hear a motion to remove item G?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Item G has been removed from the consent agenda. With those two add-ons and the one removal, do I hear a motion to approve the or adopt the agenda?
I make the motion we adopt the agenda with the two items added and then the removal of item G.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Agenda has been adopted. Next is our consent agenda. These items are typically non-controversial. If anyone has any questions, please let us know. Item A, to reclass a fire training captain from level 29 to a battalion chief position, level 32, effective upon council approval. Item B, to authorize the City of Burlington to retain Stout Stewart McGowan and King LLP for services for the fiscal year 2018-2019 annual audit. Item C, to set a date of public hearing for March 19, 2019 for citizens to comment on area housing and community development needs for the 2019-2020 annual action plan. Item D, to approve the 2019 fee schedule modifications for Indian Valley Golf Course and the Maynard Aquatic Center fees. Item E, to award a one-year contract extension to TransDev Services, Inc. at a rate of $52.46 per revenue hour for fixed route services effective July 1st, 2019 through June 30th, 2020. Item F, to award a one-year contract extension to TransDev Services, Inc. at a rate of $52.92 per passenger trip for the paratransit service of Link Transit, effective July 1st, 2019 through June 30th, 2020. Item H, to approve a request to temporarily close the following streets on May 4th, 2019 from 8 a.m. until 3 p.m. for the B-Town Events Spring Into Wellness Block Party Special Event. The details of those closures are spelled out in your agenda. Item I, to approve a request from St. Mark's Church to hold a baptism at Lake Kamak Marina on August 25th, 2019 from 3 p.m. to 7 p.m. Permission is also required from the North Carolina Department of Environmental Quality Public Water Supply Section. The petitioner will also be required to provide lifeguards. Item J, to adopt a resolution setting a date of public hearing for March 19, 2019 to consider the Alamance West Department's contiguous voluntary annexation. And item K, to adopt a resolution setting a date of public hearing for March 19, 2019 to consider the Huffman Point contiguous voluntary annexation. Do I hear a motion to approve the consent agenda items?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Consent agenda items have been approved. We have two items of new business this evening. Item one, City Council will consider awarding a contract to VHB Inc. in the amount of $126,179.18 for the development of the Burlington Graham Metropolitan Planning Organization 2045 Metropolitan Transportation Plan. At this time, we recognize MPO Administrator Juanetta Millett. Welcome.
Welcome. Thank you for having me this evening. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Juanetta Millett. I'm the MPO Administrator and the City of Burlington's Transportation Planner. Tonight, I'll be providing an overview of our Metropolitan Transportation Planning process, as well as our professional services contract, and answer any questions that you may have. So who we are. The Burlington Graham MPO is the federally designated transportation planning agency for our region. Our region includes all of Alamance County and portions of Orange and Guilford County. Up to the east, our boundary extends to Buckhorn Road, and to the west to Rock Creek Dairy Road. As the City of Burlington is the lead planning agency, they're also responsible for MPO administration, so that's why I'm a city employee as well. Our board is governed by our members' jurisdictions, of which two of your council members represents the City of Burlington, Councilman Bob Ward and also Jim Butler. Councilman Ward also serves as our vice chair. The Transportation Advisory Committee is our decision-making policy board. It sets our regional transportation agenda and our vision, and it also guides our activities as well as adopts all of our transportation plans and sets our policy. What do we do? The MPO establishes and manages a fair and impartial setting in which to conduct the overall regional transportation process. Our budget is comprised of 80% federal funds, which requires a 20% local match. Our work tasks, excuse me, and activities are identified in our annual MPO work plan, and this is adopted by our board and also approved by the federal government as well as NCDOT. Our major work tasks include establishing our transportation improvement plan, and what I'll be discussing further is our metropolitan transportation plan. So the Metropolitan Transportation Plan is our long-range regional transportation plan. It has a 20-year minimum horizon with consistency with our existing and future land use growth plans. The MTP must also demonstrate physical constraint. That means all the transportation projects that are included and identified in the plan, we have to identify a source of revenue in which to fund those programs. The MTP also includes all modes of transit, transportation. That means it's multimodal, includes highway, bike, pedestrian transit, aviation, and rail projects. And it's a key criteria for inclusion in our state improvement plan. All the projects that are developed in this plan will be included in the state plan. The next update of the MTP is expected to be very difficult to predict related to transportation and technology and advances in technology that will happen. To that end, extension and comprehensive public involvement process will be vital to the overall development of the MPT and success. Citizen staff and elected officials, your constituents will play an instrumental role in its development. And we anticipate several workshops throughout the region through the course of this year. Last August, the MPO solicited RFPs from a number of firms. Three firms responded, VHB Raleigh, AECOM, and Remy Kemp and Associates. An evaluation committee that consisted of the MPO staff, the City of Burlington staff, and NCDOT staff evaluated the proposals and presentations. VHB Incorporated was ranked the most qualified based on their experience, their references, and their project approach and presentation. The negotiated contract that you have before you for consideration is approximately $126,179.18. Funding of this project will consist of 80% federal funds, and it requires a 20% local match of $25,235.84. Funds for the local match are programmed in this current MPO transportation budget under professional services. And the estimated completion date is expected to be May 20th of 2020 of this year. There was a typo identified in the scope of services, and that has since been corrected. That concludes my brief presentation, and I'll be happy to answer any questions that you may have.
Thank you. Any questions from council?
You said it would be difficult to project, and is that because of the growth that we
Aparts the growth, aparts the technological advances in transportation. We don't know what proportion of ride sharing it's going to be in the future of transportation. Also, some other like drone related to freight movement. So some of those unknown variables in the future. Is it going to be all autonomous vehicles? It's going to be, just don't know. And we'd like to solicit your input into how we guide that process moving forward.
Since we serve as a bridge area between the Triad and Triangle regions, will part of the scope include looking at some of our surrounding MPOs?
Yes, definitely. In fact, two of the MPOs serve, I don't know, one of their chairs, I'm sorry, the technical chairs serves us on our board, so we'll have their input as well.
Excellent.
And they're identified as one of our stakeholders.
Other questions from council? Do I hear a motion to approve this contract?
Make a motion that we approve the contract as presented to VHB.
Second.
Any questions regarding the motion to approve the contract with VHB? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion is approved. Thank you, Linda.
Thank you so much.
Our second item of new business tonight, council will consider temporarily closing the following streets during the 48th annual Elements Region Antique Automobile Club of America Car Show on Saturday, May 18, 2019. From 7 a.m. until 4:30 p.m., conditional upon meeting all requirements of the special events application process. Details of those closures are spelled out in your agenda. At this time, we recognize event coordinator John Cox. Welcome back.
Seems like I'm coming every year, doesn't it? Can't get out of it. As you see, it's the 48th annual. At the depot, we have not been able to determine, but it's at least over 10 years at the depot, maybe 20. We'll keep researching that. Would like to, as usual, say thank you to your planning department there. Emily is very excited about doing this. It's always good to go into some place and see someone that's really excited about their doing their job every day and how they do it. She had a board up there that was stickies and so on that she'd gone somewhere, and that's how they do things. But it worked very well for a flow chart. So anyway, we request permission to do it again. Hopefully you have good weather. If not, we go with what we've got.
Awesome. Any questions from council? All right.
We approve the temporary street closing.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Any questions regarding the motion to approve? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion is passed. Thank you, John. Appreciate
Mr.
it.
Mr. Cox, you realize the mayor is responsible for the weather.
That's right.
So, you put pressure on him, but just remind him, especially if it rained, remember that.
I think last year was kind of bad.
Yeah, it was. So. Yeah. Exactly.
Redeem ourselves this year. That completes our new business item, and this time we have public comment. Beverly, we did not have anyone sign up for public comment. Moves us to council comments. Do I hear any council comments this evening?
Do we have some students here today?
We have a couple students in the back.
In the class?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. Would you all like to introduce yourself and which program or class you're with?
Sure. We're Elon students.
Awesome.
And we are taking this course called Natural Resource Management. Anyway, we were assigned to come and basically sit in into one of these council meetings, and definitely learning a lot today. Didn't know how this runs, so it's kind of cool.
Awesome.
And thank you for having us.
Welcome. Glad to have you here. Any other council comments? Couple quick announcements. Our free bulk waste pickup is in effect, so if you're looking to do some spring cleaning, you can bring stuff to the curb and we're happy to take it away for you, make that process a little easier. In just a couple weeks, we have our St. Patty's Day bash downtown, parade and other events. Exciting time. This is our fourth year for that festival. Folks can come down. It will be family friendly starting at 5 p.m. until 10 p.m. So we hope to see lots of folks, and again, we hope for some good weather for that festival as well. Some folks may remember recently I signed on to an ICE letter along with mayors from around the state. Just wanted to clarify that that was a unilateral decision and did not represent the total views of our city council. And then, especially with our Elon folks here, happy Elon Day to all of our Elon folks in the crowd and in the city. A lot of good activities going on around the community today in celebration of that. And finally, our next Belong in Burlington is March 27th from 6 p.m. until 7:30 p.m. right here. It's a wonderful event for new and old residents of our community, as well as surrounding communities, to find out about all the amazing things happening here and get plugged in with some of those. So, any other council comments? Do I hear a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Thank you, everyone.